Welcome back, everybody. As many of you know, there was a hostage-taking situation in Sydney, Australia overnight. A 49-year-old Iranian-born self-proclaimed spiritual healer with a lengthy criminal record took nearly 50 people hostage at a chocolate store in Sydney. The person was a self-described sheikh. He was an advocate for the Islam faith. He had been out of jail for the honor murder of his former wife. The individual's name is Manharon Monis. Joining me this time from New York City is Middle East expert, author, and editor of Atlas Shrugs, Pamela Geller. Pamela, welcome to the show.
Hey, Rick. Thank you so much for having me.
Pamela, you've been studying this individual, Manharon Monis, at length. Tell our viewers what you can about him, please.
Well, it's deeply troubling on many levels. As you said, he was out on bail for him and his partner, Anna, murdered his wife and stabbed her to death and set her alight, set her on fire. He had been arrested this past March for sexually assaulting and indecently assaulting a young woman. He was notorious for a particular letter-writing campaign to the family of fallen heroes, fallen soldiers in Australia. He would write to the parents, he would write to the family and compare their son to a pig and to a dirty animal. And he said that their son's body was contaminated, and he referred to it as the dirty body of a pig. And he said that their son, he described their son as morally the same as Hitler, had the same moral merit. So this was a man, my point in all this, Rick, is this was a man, this was a jihadist that was well known to the authorities. Why he was out on bail with a rap sheet as long as he had is beyond me. He was a deeply devout jihadist. And what's even more troubling is that yesterday, the Prime Minister of Australia said they had no idea what the motive was. The Deputy Commissioner said they had no idea what the motive was. The Police Commissioner said he had no idea what the motive was. This was after the hostages were forced to hold the Islamic State flag in the window of this popular chocolate shop, the Lynn Chocolate Shop. And I believe they were targeted because they refused to do halal certification, which, as you know, is a racket. You don't have to certify chocolate. It's not meat. So this is a way of making money, actually financing terror, but that's a whole other segment. So they knew who this man was. So the idea that they don't know what the motive is just, at this point in time, 13 years after 9/11, are we still going down this delusional path? It's insane. And the follow-up campaign to this, Australians tweeting, I'll ride with you, you know, for fear of reprisals that never come, backlashophobia that never comes, Islamophobia that never comes. How come we don't see these campaigns for Jews? You know, Jews can't walk down the street with a Jewish star or a kippah. How come we don't see these campaigns? I'll walk down the street with you. You never do. Even here in the States, over 60% of the hate crimes are anti-Semitic. Only 11%, the lowest of these classifications, are Muslim.
And also, Pamela, to make your point, stunningly, as I pointed out earlier in the show, an MSNBC television host went on the air in the last 24 hours or early yesterday and said, let's not jump to conclusions. He may not be a true believer in Islam. He might be hiding behind Islam just to hide his criminal track record. It's like they're trying to overcompensate in the name of political correctness. Why not just tell the truth as what it is? Bizarre, Pamela Geller, that this individual was out on bail for the murder of his ex-wife. How does someone, as you say, he stabbed her and then set her on fire? How does someone get out on bail on that?
How indeed? And it's really even deeper than political correctness. It's the Sharia. I love the, you know, MSNBC host saying that he's hiding behind Islam. Well, if Islam is a religion of peace and it's all sweetness and light, then how could he hide behind something that was so sweet and peaceful? It's ridiculous on its face. I'd like to know why, in the wake of these jihadi attacks, Muslim groups are not instituting programs against jihad recruitment, instituting programs to expunge Islamic texts and teachings of the violent verses.
Is it because they are intimidated and fearful for their own lives?
Where intimidated by whom? Intimidated by what? There's nobody challenging them. How and where are they being intimidated?
What I mean is if someone in Islam steps up and speaks out against the jihadists, do they themselves become a target of the jihadists?
The individual, yes, I understand what you're saying, but it's not just that they become the target of a jihadist, which all of us that do this work, I mean, I have a death threat file, you know, 5 inches thick. No, the real crime is that the moderates, the Islamic Society of North America, CARE, the Council of American Islamic Relations, who are partnering with the DOJ, the Department of State, the Obama administrations, they target these Muslims that speak out. If you go back to Peter King's hearings, if you recall his radicalization hearings, there were Muslim families that spoke out because their children were recruited. Their children had gone to Somalia to wage jihad. CARE and Congressman Keith Ellison, also known as Hakeem Muhammad, were targeted. They targeted these families. They targeted these parents, accused them of being Islamophobes for speaking out against jihad recruitment.
Right.
So my answer to you is it's the quote-unquote mainstream moderate Muslims that are going after anyone that speaks out, particularly their own. So who are they to turn to?
Pamela Geller, always an eye-opener to have you with us. We appreciate you joining us in exposing the light, especially this individual's background, on a very important moment. Thank you for joining us from New York.